Hey Trent, the watch should be arriving this morning and we will confirm condition and repackage it and ship it right out to you. So you should have tomorrow. There should be a camera like walking into the store
Yeah, I got that
in the
in the
in
corner.
that corner facing this way so it
Yeah.
can do see both halls,
Pretty much got the
one
camera
right
angle.
here into the dining room, one
Yeah.
the other way. So one in that corner, one in this corner.
Right.
And then in every
In every office.
single office,
But
but
so
at
you
the back, at the
have the
back
back
facing the door,
facing.
yeah.
That's what I thought. All right.
We have a Zoom call at 10 with Nishu. There's Trent. See in here? Trent.
Same thing. This way. Yeah, we want camera facing corner out.
Is Trent? Did FedEx come? Oh shit.
I'll be in touch, man.
Oh yeah. Anything addressed to me, can you take to my office? Trent, I need the AP brick for Brandon. I need the white gold diamond necklace. And then one of Brandon's, remember that diamond Elingi AP that Brandon consigned with us?
Yes.
Okay, it had a diamond bezel. We put a white strap on that watch. It came with a black strap. Can we find that black strap? So the three pieces I need are the strap, the AP brick, and the diamond bracelet or diamond necklace. Cool. Yeah, let's take all these into my office. All right, cool. Malka picked up yesterday, right?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
I would confirm that with Marco though, because he's the one that was talking to him.
Okay,
But I
cool.
did see them here.
They were here? Okay, cool. There was a slip on my desk. I was just making sure. Thank you, sir. Just throw those in that chair. Do we have a. Can you find me one of the good pocket knives? Or one of the good knives? Thanks, dude. Okay.
Out of
It's
all of
the.
these are all of the bracelets, necklaces, and safe.
It's that white one.
Okay,
Yeah.
very well.
Yo.
Hey, Ronnie's done with the safe. Are you still here?
Yeah, I'm coming right. I'll be right there. I'm around the corner.
All right, he'll be right back up.
Okay.
All right, bye. Hey, come on in. Let's get all these over and you can sit.
You know that package information you gave me to follow up on?
Yes, one of them came.
One of them came.
Mm-hmm.
So apparently they sent the other ones back to the sender.
Okay.
So on 12/10, they created a return label back
Okay,
to
so
the
just the other
sender.
day. Oh, back to the sender,
Back
okay.
to the sender on 12/10.
Okay, I can message them
Yeah.
right now and tell them that. They're super cool.
They
They were
are.
like, look, if you can't find them,
Yeah.
we'll get you new ones.
Okay.
So
Yeah,
I'll
I just
message
got a
them.
follow-up today on it, and
Hey, so good news is one of the briefcases were delivered and it looks absolutely amazing. So thank you for that, period. The second one, however, it looks like FedEx created a return label on December 10th to send back to you guys. Cool. You have
Did
fun
the
last
food
night?
go? I had
Did your son like the food?
Yeah, he
Did he?
did.
Nice. That's awesome.
He was
How old is he?
amazed. Like,
How old is Christian?
he's 8.
Eight, okay. That's our normal outings.
It's
So.
like that every time.
That was actually a very subpar experience, if you ask anyone that's ever been on those things.
What?
The Nick and Sam's last night.
Subpar.
Subpar.
Yeah, I know.
I told him that. I was
It
like,
tastes
look,
better.
nobody's ever waiting on us again, but the two girls that normally wait on us.
Yeah.
Because they know, like, whenever you do fine dining, especially a big party like that, and someone, like, I mean, I'm nobody special, but I eat there enough that they know,
yeah,
they know how we like things. Mm-hmm. And it's just with fine dining, you're supposed to.
Good.
All right, cool. You too, man. Thank you, Ronnie. It's just with fine dining, you're supposed to course a meal out. You stage it, or you know, whenever the first round of appetizers comes, when people stop picking, mm-hmm, you consolidate, you move it out of the way, and you get the next course in.
Right.
When the people stop picking on that, you consolidate or you move it all off, reset the table for dinner, and it should happen like
in a flow.
Exactly. Not, oh, these guys have like not touch their food in 20 minutes, now let's clear the table off, and then 15 more minutes goes by, then we set the table, and then 10 more minutes goes by, then we bring the food. I was like, dude, you're it gets to a point where I like lost my appetite for part of the night.
Yeah.
So I like these boxes. What the hell? I don't know, but there's an AP and a really big Rolex box. Just literally just an empty box. Did we get boxes from somebody? Oh, you know what? Is this Matt? Oh, and no pillow. Dude, what the hell? With a missing pillow, this box is completely useless. Empty. This was either Matt or Danny. Like, we left boxes somewhere. Oh, I know who these are.
What?
These are from, can't say the name on camera, but these are from my Vegas guy.
Oh.
Yeah, that makes sense. That means one of these have all the papers in them. Well, I already have the watches. I flew out there and picked all the watches up. Yeah, he just sent me all the boxes and papers, yeah. Yep. Do what? Well, when I pick up that many watches, I picked up 8 watches from one person and 3 watches from another. So you think to take to carry these boxes back, it's too much hassle. It's easier to just ship them. So all these boxes that just came in, these are the cards and the booklets to all the watches I brought back from Vegas on consignment. And these are all the boxes. Ugh. Whenever Trent gets back, those are the papers to all the watches that are left over. Have him match them to the boxes and log those for inventory.
What is up?
What's up, buddy?
How you doing? Where you at?
Good, man. I'm in my office. Grinding away.
Very cool.
Yeah. It's the temp office.
I just got back from London. Did a site inspection there. We're going to be doing some ridiculous things. And then I'm off to Miami.
Oh, yeah?
On Thursday for the next Bitcoin conference.
Oh, yeah. That's happening. Nice.
Earlier, it is instead of June, it's in April. And it is going to be ridiculous.
I want a booth.
Absolutely.
I want a big ass booth. Big.
Oh, yeah.
Like a whole block. I'm in LA like every other week as it is. I get a ton of business when I'm out there. So it only makes sense. I can build the TPG brand insane out there, and it spreads even faster when Dallas, you know, you've got Dallas, Austin, and Houston. You're very limited. I don't have a desire at all to go to Houston. Austin, it could work, but the amount of money and time you'd have to put into that, the same amount of effort could triple, quadruple, 10. I could actually 10x my numbers by being on the West Coast versus staying in Texas. So
Well, that is awesome. That is awesome news. If we are going to be building a showroom out there, I want to start sooner rather than later.
So
you have all of your insurance.
As far as I know, I'll double check it right now. But
again, you told me you were going to handle it, and that was right before I went to London about two and a half weeks ago.
I mean, I sent them all of my information. They sent me a payment portal, and I set it all up. So. As long as they, it should be good as far as I know.
I essentially, there's a certificate. Again, my team can tell you which one, what the name is, right? Certificate of insurance, I'm sure. But I don't know if it has to have certain people named or a certain amount of coverage, etc. But I'm assuming that Travis told you to get the right stuff.
Right.
So my team needs to get that. A copy of that,
okay,
so that we can actually proceed. That's what we were waiting for.
Okay.
With we can't destroy any of the things that exist there and demo anything until you have insurance. Does
gotcha.
That make sense?
Like, yes.
We have our own general contractor's insurance. They already have a copy of that, but I need to submit a copy of your insurance.
Okay.
Does that make sense to do things?
I just text Travis right now.
All right. So we're going to go over two things. We're going to go over two things today, which are the timeline and then the cost. The timeline is in front of you right now, and I will send this over to you.
Okay.
The cost, I don't want to cut that out.
Let's do the cost first so I can know if I want to stay on the call.
You got it. There's the bottom line.
Holy f***. Wow.
So let me show you how this is breaking down. We have all of your general contracting, which is literally just a hair under. So that's all the millwork, your conference room, all the monitors, your broadcast rooms. It includes all of the demo, the concrete work, the carpentry, all of your painting, everything, right? It also includes all of the reinforcement for your the work, the labor for the reinforcement of your vault and your shipping rooms.
Okay.
So that, I think, we knew we were going to be, we were targeting. I think that it's a little bit above. We increased what we wanted to do with like the fire shit and blah, 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 blah. But that is what that is. What the office furniture, this is a placeholder. So ultimately, I will submit to you a piece by piece thing for your sign off with individual cost. Okay? It's a placeholder. I didn't want to give you a budget and have a giant, you know, hole or a zero there. Your furniture is going to cost you something. You just went through that. I don't care if you bring your old furniture, like, right? Like I buy it from whoever you got before. I just want you to know that decking out a place as big as this is going to have a cost,
right?
Whether you get it from me, whether you get it from whoever, like, it doesn't matter. I prefer you get it from me, but it doesn't really matter. You need to have in your budget, in your head, a placeholder. And for what you have designed and this many rooms, this is an accurate budget, okay? Again, you wouldn't be committing to this until we give you a piece by piece, you know what I mean? Like, here's the desk, here's how much it costs. Do you approve or not?
Right.
This is what's screwing us. This is what is, and I can't do a damn thing about this. Like, our markup is 10%, so I have 26K in here. But it is just all of the permitting, which has gone up recently. There's also an increase in cost because of what we want to do to the floor. It's all of your review fees, our insurance, remodel taxes, the architecture and structural engineering fees. It's just, this you and I hadn't really accounted for. I think you knew you were going to get in furniture. I think we had a pretty decent design budget around like labor and shit like that. But this is what it is, right?
Okay. You know, Here we go. Finally. Do I have to sign right? Oh, I gotta sign. Okay. You guys have been waiting for. Oh, all these packages.
What do you got?
Shut up and wait.
It's an RM30.
Oh yeah, you taking bets? Oh. Oh, he did bet me 10-1 odds. He could guess what it is. Oh, boy. All right, so Marco made me a 10-1 odds bet. He could guess what it was. What is your, you get three guesses, Marco. I'll give you three guesses. I'll give you three guesses. If he wins, I bet him $1,000. If he wins, I owe him $10,000. If he loses, he owes me $1,000. I'm fair. I made it in his favor because I know he's going to lose. So I traded the AP Black Ceramic Perpetual Calendar, my full rose gold root beer, my Hulk, and $2,000 for this. So, Marco, I need you to tell me what your guesses are. Who are you texting?
No. Elliot.
Don't you text Elliot. I already told him. I told Elliot if he snitches, we're done. We break. What did he say?
Because I was like, you're saying that on him? He's like, yup. And I was like, thank you.
So Marco thinks he got to my source.
Elliot says it is a rose gold 1103 flyback.
Well, you better hurry up. You got 14 seconds.
No, I'm going to guess a 3501.
Who's...
3501.
I would wish. Actually, the 3503 would be sick.
All right, it's an ARM 11. I'm going to go with ARM 11.
Yeah. Is that what it is, bro? Did you get a 30? Did you get? Wow. I wanted to see that.
Better.
With an 11, I'll get the Lipa Masa.
Is that your final bet? Final mother. Elliot, I don't like peanuts. Come on, bro. I hate peanuts. You know what? I will accept.
Sorry, I really hate this thing.
Look, hold just.
I'm holding it.
Is it down though? It's not like all the space above me.
I've got your forehead cut off.
Don't cut my forehead off, dude. I don't even know what to do with all these peanuts.
No, don't do that.
Nah, that. Have you ever done that? It's a pain in the ass. And they never get picked up. Do what? Just hold it still.
Like if I want to turn.
Well, hold it still.
You have to hold it by this.
Hang on. 1 second. Video crash course. No, watch. Look. Keep it down.
Okay. I'm doing that.
No, look. Now hold the trigger.
What trigger?
Oh, there's a trigger. Stays locked.
Oh, I didn't know there was a trigger. Okay.
Look, so you just hold. Yeah. Okay. Keep it right there and hold that trigger.
Okay, cool. Excuse me. Perfect. Okay.
But put it a little. Hang on. Let go of the trigger. Okay.
I'm just trying to figure it out.
No, but if you pull the trigger, it locks it on the.
Okay.
Keep it right. Hang on. Go that way. Go right.
Try it. Well,
no. Okay. Let go of the trigger.
I'm
look,
not on
look,
it.
Look. Look. You
trigger.
Keep this thing. This is the front. Okay. You use that to aim it.
Oh, and then I got you. And then.
So you've got it locked right there.
Yeah.
Push the trigger to unlock it.
And then you. Just
now you go up.
It. I see.
Just like that. Now hold the trigger
and then
right there.
If
you move, it'll stay locked. Now hold the trigger.
Okay.
There you go. All right, hang on. Let me get rid of these f***ing peanuts. Elliot, I'm not sending you $2,000. This costs $2,000. Mother f***.
That's a Rolly box. He said you didn't even get it. Oh, shit.
So go ahead and sell me my $1,000. Since you guessed RM.
A Rolly box? I thought it was an RM.
That's what Marco thought, too. That's why I was generous with his bet.
I still have two guesses.
Go ahead and guess. You got 2 seconds.
A Rolex that costs $330.
It has to be an Arabic dial.
It is an Arabic dial Daytona, you piece of shit.
It has to be an Arabic dial Daytona.
It is. Look at his smile. It gives it away.
Arabic dial Daytona is... Oh, yeah, it could be an Arabic dial Daytona.
TBR.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Hang on.
Absolutely. 330.
Hang on. We got one more into the mix. Roman, you're just in time.
What the f*** is going on your desk?
Well, for one, Elliot sent me a box full of peanuts, so I'm not paying him the extra $2,000 I owe him. But my Malka just arrived.
He got a Arabic Daytona TBR.
That's $500,000. I wish.
No, they're not.
Yes, they are. Bullshit.
Oh, sorry.
A TBR with the baguette bezel?
They're not 500. The Arabic dial, maybe, yes. But not the... All right, let's see. Hold on, wait. How do I...
Let me enjoy it for just a second.
I still...
I think... Marco, you got one more guess, right?
think.
No, this is getting sexually uncomfortable.
Oh yeah. Marco, what's your guess?
What's that? You showing somebody?
It's my watch. You got one more guess. You got 4 seconds before I show.
Platona. That's all I can think of. Oh, I already know. I should have guessed. Okay, can I tell you what it is?
What?
Yeah, orange bezel, mother of pearl. Yeah.
What?
That was $330.
Yeah. Whatever I overpaid, I don't care.
I think you did okay.
I didn't overpay. You know what?
I want to talk to you about something else.
Okay. Well, it's on camera right now.
Yesterday we had a conversation of you looking at a $600,000 Girard Perregaux that retails for like $1.6 million, right?
Yes.
It's unique. It's this and the other.
Yep.
So I have a dumb question to ask you.
Yep.
Rather than, I don't know what that Girard Perregaux is, but I told you yesterday, no matter what it is, I don't want you spending $600,000 on a GP.
Understandable, Karen. Go ahead.
So rather than spending $600,000 on a GP, I have a better offer for you. You know my piece unique Audemars Piguet Grand Comp minute repeater perpetual calendar split second chronograph automatic. Say you, that fast 5 times.
You just lost me at the very beginning of that. So take a breath and say that again.
So you know my.
That's a massive watch, though.
That's a what?
That is a massive watch. It's 44 millimeters and weighs like 6.4 pounds.
Thick as a hockey puck, too.
But at least you know there's a lot of gold value there. But so why would you take Girard Perregaux X, which historically has the worst resale value outside of maybe Romain Jerome, and plop $600,000 into that, where a watch that I'm currently selling for $750 that I'll sell to you, let's say, for $620, which is a piece unique, has two auction records, was made for Prince Albert's Foundation for Water, and it's a one of one. That's a skeleton Royal Oak perpetual minute repeater chronograph, split second chronograph.
Because trying to convince someone the value of that, you're gonna lose them. The piece that I'm looking at,
hold on, stop. There's an auction record of that watch at $520,000 already.
Understandable, but the piece that I've got in mind, and you'll understand when I send you a picture or a video of it, which you cannot share. When I show you the piece, you'll understand why. And it'll be a piece that is so out there that the person that buys it because he wants a watch that is visually out there and looks every bit of $1.5 million. You'll understand when you see what it is.
With one exception. I'm telling you from my 20 years experience. The mere fact that it says Girard Perregaux on it.
Sure.
Let me skip down for you. There's a reason why their skeleton rose golds and ceramics and steels don't sell for $100,000.
For right now. They don't yet. There was also a time when AP skeletons didn't sell for $100,000 or $300,000. And there was a time.
Information that you don't know. I bought Girard Perregaux closeouts directly from Girard Perregaux. Do you know how many of those skeletons they made?
I do not.
Thousands.
Perfect. Perfect.
I personally was privy to a deal, which I bought a little chunk of, but I didn't buy the whole deal, that had 880 of those skeletons in it. And at the time, I was buying the gold at 19,000.
How long have those been in production?
They've been in production for probably a good 5 years. But
regardless, whether...
I don't care if you buy my watch or not. You have to understand the business model behind Girard Perregaux. Do you see a lot of Girard Perregaux boutiques, billboards, commercials, any of that nature?
Nope.
No, because they're a closeout brand. What that means is they manufacture for the sheer purpose of selling the stuff in bulk at a high discount and let it dissipate along the gray market. How many authorized dealers have you walked into in the last 2 years where you saw the Girard Perregaux line?
None. But here's the thing.
There's a reason for that.
Here's the thing, though. The primary market is getting fed up with the fact that all anybody talks about, if you look up, type in luxury watch, look up YouTube videos. All anybody's talking about is Rolex, Patek, AP, Richard Mille. Okay, great. It's sexy. It's fun. Most of us can't afford it. On top of that, you can't even see this stuff. So it's just becoming this imaginary land of like maybe these watches do exist. Maybe they don't. I don't know. I can't afford them. People are getting fed up with the bullshit that the ADs, Rolex, AP, Patek, and Richard Mille are playing. They're tired of the games. They are starting to turn to other brands. It's inevitable. It's going to slowly happen. What? Hey, let me ask you this. Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
3 years ago, no, 2017, you didn't see that many Rainbow Daytonas out there. And I actually remember when I was in the beginning of the business, you could buy a Rainbow Daytona slightly over retail. It was not the stupid 5X markup that it is today.
It was 50 grand over list.
Okay, so what happened? Adam Levine wore it in the Super Bowl, February 2017. The following month, it's all over Instagram. 2 months later, you see Ellen DeGeneres is wearing one. Elton John is wearing one. Mark Wahlberg has one. Kevin Hart has one. All these superstars, one person wears it and it's the right person to wear it. People hop on the bandwagon. They start through it. Now look at the Rainbow Daytona. That's just one example. Look at many other watches out there that a specific person has worn and has hyped it up. Now, not saying that the whole GP brand has to come up and stuff trade over retail for me to be able to sell a $1.5 million GP at $1.5 million. What has to happen is I have to wear that piece. I have to keep that piece in my collection for a little while and not sell it. And eventually someone's going to come. And here's, aside from that, you have to start promoting the fact that it is impossible to get watches. Why pay 5X retail when you can still buy stuff under retail?
And that's where I'm going to prevent you from making a $600,000 mistake. You can send me whatever that watch is. You send me that video tomorrow. I make one phone call, and I'll have 10 of them made in different variations. And it's going to cost me less than $600,000.
I'll buy them all.
No, you won't, because tomorrow I'll make 10 more. And I'll make 10 more.
You can get GP.
Tell me about this watch. So this is a piece unique, one-off Daniel Roth, right? Daniel Roth no longer exists. It's bought over by Bulgari. Now Bulgari, Daniel Roth watch.
You would like that, Nishu. All
right? So they made one of these. Oh, look. It's Nishu. All right, so they made one of these. The retail is 498,000 Swiss francs. What is this watch worth?
400, how much?
497,000 Swiss francs. Let's call it 500,000 US.
Shit, 160?
Okay.
65,000.
I'll sell you this watch for 125. What's a better buy?
My $600,000 piece unique?
Absolutely not.
Whenever you see what it is, and I explain to you the context behind I think I can, yes.
Anthony, you know that I love you, right? You know that I got a lot in my heart for you. However, I'm a roll with Roman on this.
Yeah, I gotta roll.
Get an AP over a GP.
All right, look.
A GP at that rate is risky. It's risky.
Risk is what keeps you alive, my friend.
Fair enough. It's like going 150.
Hang on.
Answer my question as a business person, not as Anthony,
okay,
who's hot-headed and cocky, which is great. I'm the same way. So,
no, Roman, you're humble.
In that versus parking it in a proven brand, a better watch, the most complicated piece ever made, and a one of a kind that has an auction result record of 520,000 already.
You want to know the honest to God answer for that?
Yeah.
Because it's not about the money. There are some pieces that I buy that I could give two shits. If I put $600,000 in a watch and it tanks, it. Then I still have in my head a $600,000 watch that nobody else on the planet has. And I'm okay with that. Because you know what? $600,000, while it is a lot of money, that is pennies in the buckets to what I see myself making throughout my life.
Lots of Gerard Perregaux's. And they're all pieces unique. And I showed you 100 of them. Would that make that one less appealing?
No, because I have my sights set on this one. And here's the thing, dude, when it comes to emotion, you can't fake emotion. Whenever you see a piece, and I've told this to brand new clients, you think you want this watch because DuPont Registry and AP and Richard Mille are very, very good, and they have very, very great graphic designers that know how to make that thing look sexy in magazine on commercials. But then when you physically have it in your hand and you put it on the wrist and that spike of serotonin doesn't go through your veins and you just forget about every other watch in your collection, if you don't have that feeling, that watch isn't for you. A piece that's $1.5 million that I can buy for $600,000, $300,000.
That retail is irrelevant.
Right, of course. But
things for the sole purpose of high, the retail is irrelevant.
Damn it, I picked the wrong thing up. Pay attention, you guys. You know what? Here's the thing about it is whenever I saw that piece in person, it invoked an emotion that you very rarely see, especially for someone like us in this business.
That's all that matters.
Right.
For me, honestly, the 003 was like, it spoke to me in the same way. A lot of Jordans have done the same thing. Like, if you find a piece that you absolutely love, get it.
Let me ask you a question, Nisha. You're gonna, tomorrow that GP comes in and you're absolutely in love with it, you don't give a shit, and you buy it for $600,000 and things are all fine and dandy. And then you kind of get tired of it a little bit later, and you bring it to me, and I tell you, I'll give you $150. How would that make you feel?
No. I'm on you with the GP and the risk factor. I'm with you. You don't understand, homie. Like, I would roll with your piece. I mean, your piece is thick for me. Thick, like thickness, not the 44, but the thick. But I would buy that over the GP for sure. But you can't, if a piece speaks to somebody, I mean, well, how are you going to argue against it? You know what I mean? Like, on our side. Like, you can't. You got to let, you know, like...
You're parking $600,000 in something that out the door...
Yeah.
Let me ask you this.
I agree. The liquidity, even if you're like, hey, this piece is so special, once you find somebody that it resonates with, they will pay me my $600.
Right.
Maybe he firmly believes that, but... In my opinion, given that it's a GP, it's going to take you like a year or two to find that person, right? Because it's not an AP.
Right. I have a really good client, and I love using him as an example, because he buys, you know, money. I don't want to say money is irrelevant, but he makes, you know, he can do whatever he wants. He makes enough. So he's the kind of guy that will go buy a $200,000 watch at retail because he doesn't want to wait. He doesn't like the games, the bullshit negotiating. He just wants the watch. And he'll buy it knowing, and he'll even call me, hey, how much of a loss am I going to take on this watch when I sell it to you? And I instantly tell him half. If you buy that watch and you very, very carefully wear it, and then you sell it to me in 2 months, you're going to lose $100,000. Okay, cool. I just bought it. Alright guys, so it has been an extremely long day at the office, but it's been a fun day. I added another one of my grill pieces to the collection. I got a lot of work done, and I actually had a lot of errands to run, and I got a bunch of deals done. I got so busy I forgot to start filming stuff outside of what you saw when I was talking to Nishu and Roman and everything. But anyway, good day so far. We've actually been on the road this afternoon to San Antonio, and my best friend Chris has been driving so I can work the whole way down there. Now, the reason I'm going to San Antonio is about 2 months ago, this gentleman called Justin called me up and told me a story about his son. Now, his son's been watching my channel since the beginning, since TPG first started putting out the Day in the Life videos. He's followed through with it to my personal channel, and he's adapted a lot of the stuff that I do on a daily basis. You know, the eating healthy, the working out twice a day, getting up early, taking cold showers, reading. He's just really kind of changed his life for the better. His dad even said he's lost about 40 pounds in the last 6 weeks alone. On top of all that, which, well, for one, that's pretty inspiring. That's pretty awesome to find out that something you're doing has parlayed into someone else's life and they're benefiting from it. So that's pretty cool. Now, what's even cooler is Ethan, which is the son's name, has really taken a liking to high-end watches. He told his dad he wants to be a watch dealer one of these days. So about 8 months ago, his dad started buying up watches, some really nice Rolex and everything, and kind of starting to build this small little collection that was going to be given to him to act as his starting inventory. Now,
he wasn't really sure how he was going to get into the business. He just knew that, one, he needed inventory to get started. So I posted a video, like I said, about 2 months ago, and I was talking about one of our friends that came to us. He was a dealer that came to Marco and I and asked for help on his business, on how to get started. And we worked with this guy for about a year and were able to build his business up enough to allow him to leave the corporate world and become a full-time watch dealer. When we were talking about that, Justin got the idea and he called me and he said, you know, he told me the story about his son and he's like, you name whatever it takes, tell me what I've got to do to get you to coach my son and teach him how to start a watch business. Thus was the beginning of what is now my one-year mentor and coaching program. So I actually have to start by giving you a huge thank you for starting something else in my life. Now, to go back to that, is he hired me to train Ethan. And this is going to be a birthday present for Ethan. So today is actually Ethan's birthday. We're on the way to San Antonio to go surprise him at dinner and let him know what his dad is gifting him. So it's pretty cool. It's going to be a fun night. Now, there is just one problem. For some reason, I don't know where I got San Antonio from. They're actually from Houston. So we're in Austin. It's about 3 hours out of the way. We've been on the road 3 hours. We got all the way to Austin, and I was looking up the address of the restaurant we were going to meeting at when we got to San Antonio, and I realized it's Papa's Brothers in Westheimer. So, big fuck up on my part, you know. So we just stopped. We got some tacos at Pepe's Tacos here in Austin, and Justin and Ethan are at dinner right now, so we are going to head the other way, get to Houston as fast as we can. We're still going to make it. We're still going to make the trip. I told him the mess up we just had, and he's like, look, if you want to do another night, it's no worries, but it's Ethan's birthday. We're going to make it before the end of his birthday. I'm going to deliver on what we said we're going to do. We're going to surprise him. He still has no idea. His dad's just going to kind of postpone this as long as he can. They're going to go have dessert somewhere else, and then we're going to go meet him at a hotel bar, or I don't know, but we're going to get to Houston as fast as we can to go meet Ethan and give him his birthday present. So, but it's kind of funny at the same time. Austin, San Antonio, supposed to be in Houston, whatever. But we have a lot of tacos, and Chris is going to keep driving. I'm going to keep working, and we're going to get there. So, you ready? Let's go. Holy shit. What is all this? That quesadilla isn't. Oh, that's beans. I'm not eating that shit.
Is this like a bean drink or something?
Just beans. A bean drink? What the f? Oh, f. I just realized I can't bite into tacos. I have to like pick at it.
Not bad.
Wow. Dude, Austin tacos are the best. Wow, dude, these are legit the best tacos I've ever had in Austin.
Soaked.
I don't know. I'm not mad. Yeah, it looks like it.
I'm having a heart attack.
A lot of grease.
Good thing I took my Lipitor this morning. I really did.
Yeah, but you eat bacon like every day.
I stopped doing it. Still got a question.
Do you remember when you called me and you're like, yeah. Oh, wait, what'd you say that one day? You're like, I don't eat veggies, like at all.
Can't do that anymore.
No.
I love it. I actually like being in the city. It feels good. Dallas sucks.
It'd feel better if it wasn't the wrong city. But
yeah.
You haven't meant to be here. But alright guys. I'm not even gonna wait till the end of this to review Pepe's Tacos, but since we're here, best tacos I've ever had in Austin. It's right on Lamar Boulevard. I think it's like 704 East Lamar Boulevard. But just Google Pepe's Tacos when y'all are in town. Wow.
You got it, John.
Dude, seriously the best taco I think I've ever had in my life. All right, I think tomorrow I'm actually gonna start dieting. I'll probably be on Lipitor soon if I keep doing this. Pepe's Tacos, you have won my heart. Marco, if you're watching this, that little shitty taco truck we used to go to on the side of the 75 or 35, no more. Pepe's Tacos from now on.
No, I am a little concerned about this green sauce, though.
This shit's good.
Other than wheatgrass, what do you know that actually, from nature, is that color?
Nothing. But who cares?
Seaweed?
Who cares? You're eating tacos from a trailer. There's worse things out there for you. Like smoking meth. Sorry, Darby, I know you're still on 75 hard, and you have to edit this.
The only thing I have against, was it Pepe's Tacos?
Stay strong, bro.
The only thing I have against Pepe's Tacos is, they give you a bean drink.
No, that looks like diarrhea. Don't touch the bean stuff.
And it's, I don't know what their game plan was here, but.
You drink it.
I'm not drinking it.
You ready to go? All right, let's go. This is terrible for me, but I've been up since 5 a.m., worked out twice, been on the road for 5 hours now, still have at least, I don't know, 5 to 6 hours on the road before we get back home, so this is what's going to get me through it. Perfect combo. What's your question?
Are we still going to that restaurant in Houston?
No, we're gonna go somewhere else.
Where are we going?
Just go to that area. They're still there, but he said when they finish, he'll text me which bar they go to.
Or nice.
They're gonna go to like a hotel bar or something.
Let's do it.
Cool. Let's go. Yep.
Let's roll. Let's ride, Ghost Rider.
All right, let's get out of here. Okay, so when we walk in from the entrance, are you to the left or the right? And what color shirt is he wearing? Question mark. We just pulled up in valet, so I wanna walk in and surprise him. All right, so we just got here. Justin has his son Ethan in there. And we're gonna go in and try to surprise him a little bit. Okay, we are walking in now. You guys mind watching these for a minute? Cool, I can leave these here? What's up, man?
Stunning. He's like, why are we going over here? What are we doing?
Happy birthday.
Thanks, sir.
How are you?
Okay.
What's up, man? How are you, Justin?
That's my wife.
Nice to meet you. Anthony, nice to meet you.
So sorry you guys had a crazy.
Oh, my gosh. No, it's.
Trip,
it makes for a funny.
Fly, though.
No, okay. Well, he also said, this is Chris, my best friend.
How you doing, Chris?
That's what he said. He's like, why didn't you just fly on the way? And I was like, well. You know, if you talk about drive time to the airport, waiting in line, get on a plane, maybe Wi-Fi works, maybe it doesn't. I'd rather just drive, and for 4 hours I can work, so. What's up, man?
I know he's shocked.
Yeah?
He's speechless. He's
happy birthday.
Thank you, sir.
So, your dad, come over here, Chris. So your dad reached out to me, and he has a birthday surprise for you. I'm going to let him give it to you.
It's been a while. It's been tough for us not to tell you, but I think we're like your second coaching client we signed up for you. We're going to do it together, yeah. Stay tuned, but that's why we had you do the Instagram, signed up, banged it out, and all that.
Yeah. It's funny because I was telling him kind of the steps of what I'm going to have you guys do.
Right.
And so... It was like, as I would say stuff in my videos, so we had a phone call about 2 months ago,
yeah.
And I purposely kept that off the video, because he's like,
he watches everything you do. So I've kept everything. I've kept any hints or inclinations that would have given you an idea to it. But it's funny, whenever I was telling one of my other clients about the Instagram course, he texts me and he's like, can I call you real quick? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, oh, Ethan's now, he's like, we should do this Instagram course. So he's like, should I get it? And I was like, yeah, go ahead and get it. I'll reimburse you for it. But yeah, that's kind of funny. Yeah.
Piece by piece.
So welcome to my coaching program. And starting on January 1st, we are going to hit the ground running with Elux. Well, there's culture shock or like...
No, I just never expected to see you.
Right.
I told Anthony the story how like it's been almost exactly a year since we really started following. And when I first reached out to Marco to get mom to watch.
Can you show me the videos of him when he swept?
Yeah.
When the guy tried to sell mistake and all that.
Let me put this
over here so I'm not sure if this is going to pick. After a year and a half, you've learned every trick in the book when it comes to mics. Here, do this. Who's this?
Him.
Okay. Right. I'll put it right there. But anyway.
I was telling Anthony how, like, watching religiously, you started journaling, your working out, your diet.
How much would you lose?
Like everything. 45 pounds, I think.
Wow.
75 to 135.
Went from 175 to 135 in how long?
And he's grown probably, you know, 4 inches in that time too while dropping the weight.
That's good.
But he's been going to CrossFit with my wife every morning religiously. Changed his diet completely. Like, he won't even eat, like, bacon-wrapped steak. Tonight my wife had, you know, bacon-wrapped scallops. She's like, no. Like, he's just totally...
Love that.
Yeah. That was birthday.
Birthday present.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Nice. You don't have to call me, sir. Call Anthony. But dude, I'm excited. It's 16 years old. You realize that if we get you to where I want you within a year,
the amount of time is just
you're gonna be. So you turned 16 or turned 17?
Turned 16 today.
Turned 16. You'll be the youngest IWJG member in 2022. I promise. You'll be the youngest I've ever seen or heard of to have a booth.
Well, the only reason we've done is I've let this kind of happen was for like 7 months he's been pushing it. He's learning the models, down the price, looking at watch charts, like just following it all, watching all the videos. And he's been pushing me, and you know, I've been hesitant, like Ethan, like, you know, all it takes is one or two fake to go by us, and you know, next thing you know, you're out 50 grand, 60 grand. I'm like, you know, you gotta really, this isn't something we jump into. And he's like, okay, you know, I'll study more, I'm gonna get on it. You know, I know, watch more and more videos, but that's my biggest thing is I'm like, you know, how do we spot?
I'll tell you the biggest secret to spotting fakes that I've learned
over
the years.
There's so many scammers out there.
You buy the person, not the watch. I've learned a lot about watches. Luckily, I've never bought a fake, and I studied. I may have mentioned it in one of my videos, but the first Breitling I bought, I was watching YouTube videos on how to spot fake Breitlings on the way to the deal.
Oh, really?
And, you know, I kind of thought, I was kind of a little cocky too. And
yeah,
I got
like
there, I was like,
notes.
Oh, hang on, let me check the blue gradient on the crystal and all these things. But that's kind of how I learned. And I would study meticulously until I met my business partner, Marco, who could spot fakes from a mile away. So I quit studying watches and I started studying people. And what I've learned is you don't have to know anything about watches to spot a fake 9 out of 10 times. If you can recognize the stories that a scammer has, if you can recognize the tendencies or the inconsistencies, then you can pick them out.
The story, my uncle gave it to me.
They always have a story.
Talking fast.
It was a gift. It was this. I've got to pay for my...
Not real sure.
I've got to pay for a... That's my favorite. I've got to pay for a funeral. Tell me this. Of all the litigation that's ever happened when someone dies and the family goes to fighting over money, when has it ever been brought up, how are we going to pay for the funeral? Nobody gives a shit. They want to know what's theirs.
Yeah.
Sorry about my language.
Get their piece.
No, but they want their piece. They're not worried about how to pay for the funeral. So it just always cracks me up when scammers use, I've got to sell this watch really fast to pay for the funeral. No, you don't.
And the story's it's kind of weird, kind of vague, purposely.
Right. But you now no longer have to worry about that. You still need to study the watches as much as you can, because you can sell
I can sell any watch to any person, and I could tell you I'm going to charge you more than market value, but I sell you on the emotion of not even the watch. It's the emotion of the watch, but you have to know about the watch to invoke that emotion in someone. If you can tell a story about a watch and you can figure out someone's emotional tie to a specific watch and their connection to it, you will sell it. But you have to know about watches to do that.
Arouse an eager one in them. So
do what?
Arouse an eager one in them so that they'll, no matter what, buy it.
Yep. But it does help to, you've got to know watches too. Because then it's just, the more educated you are in watches, the better a buyer you can become. You don't have to have a lot of watch knowledge to be a seller. To be a buyer, you do. Excited?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. It's going to be fun. Well, dude, happy birthday. I'm glad I got to make it out here. I'm glad your dad stayed in touch.
Yes. Yeah, it was tough trying to not lose momentum, not tell you, because I know you kept, he never asked even once. Like, he wasn't going to ask, but he was like, hey, did you see Anthony's video today? Like, coaching client one, coaching client four. Coaching client, he was like, seen the video?
Yeah, and I threw some stuff on there, and I actually closed. I was like, I'll close it down, which I did. I closed it off for the rest of the year. Luckily, you were the first one. And so whenever this video actually comes out, I gave you a shout-out, actually.
Did you?
Because you called me and watched a video, and you heard me mention about Alex, my former, I guess, client. He was already a watch dealer.
Yeah.
He came to us, and we're like, look, we'll help you. And he's like, no, we got to pay you for your time. We still didn't think of it as a side business because it does take away from the main business. But then when you called, and you were just like, look, what do I have to do to make this happen? I was like,
You have no idea, man. And not just that, but it's just like the timing, the work he's put in kind of behind the scenes, and it just all came together perfectly. Because for me, it was like, all right, we've done these steps, we've gotten this, you know, making him, you know, you got to prove to me you have the knowledge, and we're getting closer. And I could tell he was kind of losing momentum too, kind of like, you know, is this ever going to happen? We're going to do this. And it all kind of came together where he's like, all right, we got to jump on this now.
Yeah. No, he really followed you.
Well, it's happening, so.
Really followed you.
Yeah. So now I'm going to give you my cell phone number, and I mean, you're going to text every day.
Oh.
And I'll run it all down to you. We'll hop on I'm traveling the next few days, but I think Friday morning, I've got some time in the morning before I head to Tampa. We'll hop on a Zoom call. I mean, you'll spend an hour, and we'll just kind of bullshit, talk. I'll go over what the year is going to look like, and we're going to work on, if we don't get the name, get all that set up. Before the end of the year, we'll have all the business and the social set up. Week one, what I'm going to do, I'll go ahead and give you a rundown. I haven't decided what it's going to be, Sunday or Monday nights, because maybe a Monday night, because Sundays I'm generally traveling back home or to get somewhere. So it's going to be the first day of the week. Every week, I'm going to give a lesson. We'll do a 2 or 3 hour Zoom call with everybody in it. I'll give a quick little lesson. Here's what to do. Here's how I do it. Here's why it works in my business. Here's how it'll work in your business. And then we'll do a 2-hour, 3-hour Q&A. We'll go through each one of you. Here's how to do it for you. Here's how to do it for you. Here's how to do it for you. Brainstorm and mastermind off everybody. And then for that week, you go out and practice it. You'll have unlimited access to text me anytime you want. And then we'll do a bi-weekly call. So every week is a weekly group coaching call. Every other week is an individual call where I focus on just you and your business. And then, like I said, text anytime.
Our business.
You'll never do what?
I said our business.
Yes, yes. Y'all's in each individual business.
No, I mean, but since you're in with us, we're on with that program.
Yes.
You're not.
Best of interest.
And I'm gonna get you. I'm gonna get you at an IWJG show soon.
Yes, sir.
That'll be fun. You will be amazed at what you see at a show. So, but hey, I'm going to spend some quality, some personal time with them guys. Glad you got to come along with us. So we're going to cut the camera and just hang out, visit, show some watches off, stuff like that, and just enjoy Ethan's birthday. So I'll see you guys later.
So we just left meeting Ethan. It was awesome. I mean, the kid was super stoked, and I was excited about that. I was the look on his face when I showed up, you could tell he was in kind of a little state of shock. So it was pretty cool. And then once we actually turned the camera off, he really opened up. So that was pretty awesome to see. And kid's bright. He knows his models. He's been studying. He's been studying his stuff, and he's definitely excited to get started in this business. So we're looking forward to it, man. So now we've got a long, long drive back to Dallas. So, and then long drive back to Dallas, early morning flight to San Francisco tomorrow. So, day's almost over, guys.
All over again, buddy.